And also...
Oh, God, the nightmares. They never end.
This week on Backward Compatible, Will Parsons joins us to explain the various theoretical models for time travel and where each appears in media. Plus, Jim learns about Tragedy Looper, and Doc complains about the 3DS. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 28 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, I'm Jim, and I'm salty on this one.
We're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And we're joined by our guest, Will Parsons.
Hey, I'm back again.
We made it to the future. I'm really happy about this.
Mm-hmm. Our meaty topic of discussion for today is going to be time travel, specifically various theories of time travel and different forms of time travel. And then what we're going to be doing is taking some of those theories and turning them into a game, or basically we're going to be spitballing some ideas for a game that we can make based on those theories. But, of course, the first thing...
But one problem was going to be that we have so many listeners that are game designers that they're probably going to take this idea and spin it into a multi-million dollar profit.
I don't think we have to worry about that too much.
You don't think so?
No.
Well, I have a solution. Mm-hmm. Instead of doing episode 28 when we get back, we can just go ahead and publish it now here in the future.
Okay, it's not a bad idea.
That way, when we get back, we can just run with the idea.
All right.
Cool.
Good plan.
Go to the past to save this. I don't know. Anyway, let's go into Mosh.
Get ready for the Butt Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Well, since you're the guest, you want to start us off? What have you been playing recently?
A couple of loose MMOs, but mostly Splatoon. Which is funny because I actually don't like shooters, like, at all. They're not my kind of game.
Would you say Splatoon was sort of designed with that sort of player in mind?
I think so. I know it's designed with me in mind because my number one issue with a shooter is I can't aim worth anything, and the whole point of Splatoon is to hit the ground, which I am an amazing player at. Honestly, playing Splatoon, I usually have a higher score, but that doesn't mean we win because it's not designed around just having a higher score. It's kind of cool that way.
It's like you're trying... Because I actually haven't played it yet. It's like you're trying to fill whoever fills the space with the most paint. Is that
right? Okay. It's...
Well, it's a few different modes, but the mode you're thinking of is called Turf War.
Yeah.
And the idea is that you have two sides and they're trying to cover the ground with more of their paint than the opponent's.
Right.
There have been some...
Red or blue, blood versus Crips.
Right. No, but yeah, the colors are actually randomized, so sometimes it'll be like green and orange or pink and something. And so
pink?
Yeah,
what kind of gang has pink as their gang color?
Squids.
Oh, okay.
In the 80s, maybe? I don't...
Definitely.
Yeah. But no, it's great. Like I said, I've enjoyed it. The weapons in it are just kind of fun and loose. Really, it's kind of a Nintendo kind of Team Fortress 2 manic play style to it. Hmm. One of the things that I heard someone else mention that I agree with is the fact that they're 3-minute matches, they're really quick, you have, well, when it first came out, you had no way of choosing who was on your team. No way of selecting anything like that. You were switching back and forth with players, there was never any consistency to who was on your team and who wasn't, and it was really difficult to develop any kind of, it was really difficult to create a gang. I mean, just flat out, you couldn't make a game and or a group of whatever to fight other people. So there was no...
And that's just un-American.
There was no
Can't
anger.
Make a game. Come on.
I mean, it's a shooter game with no anger. I mean, there's also no voice chat, so that doesn't matter. But there's no vindictiveness to it.
Which is what makes it good.
Yep. And the
topic for another day.
No vindictiveness.
No voice chat.
A shooter with no anger, people not rage quitting? Oh, I don't know.
Oh, no, people rage quitting
happens.
There is rage quitting. Oh, okay, good.
You just don't hear about it.
Oh, well, okay then.
Here's the other thing. When someone on your team rage quits, you can still get benefit to continuing to play. Because all the points that you make, you still get. It's not like other games.
Yeah, there's an experience system. Yeah. So.
Okay. There's benefit to continuing play when someone else quits.
Rage,
which I like.
The theme of the episode.
Yes, rage.
I thought it was time.
Rage.
Or rage.
It's,
or
rage, it's rage time.
Rage and time.
Time to rage.
Time to rage.
Doc, what has your gaming experience been like this week?
Well, in an upcoming episode, we are going to be doing Fire Emblem. So,
Fire Emblem Awakening specifically.
Sure, there's a difference.
Well, it's one in a long running series.
Right. Because I knew that. Anyway, being a complete and total Fire Emblem noob, as well as a complete and total 3DS virgin, Chris was kind enough to loan me his 3DS. So I thought I'd talk just a little bit about my experience with this new handheld device slash console. I hate it.
Really?
I do. I absolutely hate everything about the 3DS.
Which version do you have?
That's a good question.
I don't know. It's sitting over there on the counter.
It's the XL.
The XL? Like the first XL?
First XL.
Okay.
Is there a difference? I don't know. I know nothing about 3DS.
There's a new 3DS that has an additional little thumbstick on the other side.
So okay. It's like a little nub.
Yeah.
Oh, good. It's another, got two of them. Another annoying thumbstick. That's good.
But you can use the thumbstick or you can use the D-pad.
Okay.
I use them both depending on the game.
Sure.
Sounds great. I like the 3DS quite a bit. What don't you like about it? Is it you don't like the thumbstick?
Well, where to start? My experience with 3DS up to this point has been confiscating it from students. other than that, I think there's an uncomfortable element. I have not felt this uncomfortable holding a controller since the 8-bit. It's too heavy to be that clunky. It's not ergonomic. It doesn't fit my hand well.
Have you considered lifting weights?
With my fingers?
I'm kidding.
Okay.
Have you ever played on a Sega Nomad?
Actually, no. No.
The Game Gear, I think, was horrible about it.
Well, if we're talking about old systems that have bad design, I would even go as far as to say that whenever you hold a PS3 controller for long enough, the place where the screw on the back is can dig into the meaty part of your hand. I have a meaty hand. Meaty part of your hand and start to rub it raw. But this is a 21st century device. This has no excuse for being designed like it was designed in the 90s. It's clunky.
It's designed the way it is because it needs to fit in a pocket.
And I understand that. Yeah. I get it. But the problem is that the buttons themselves, I'm so very used to a Sega mapping system where the X button is.
You mean the Xbox?
No, I mean
Sega.
Sega didn't matter.
What am I saying?
You're saying I'm used to Sega.
Sorry, Sony. Oh. Sorry, Sony.
Oh, Sony. Okay.
Hello, Sony. I'm so very used to a Sony controller with PlayStation that
you hear X and think B.
I do.
Yeah,
I do exactly.
Well, that sounds like a personal problem,
and it probably is. Regardless, I hit that stupid B button every single time. Now, don't get me wrong. I was a Nintendo gamer. I got into Nintendo from the very start. I absolutely loved the Super Nintendo. So I don't think the B and A button have changed any, have
they? No, it's the exact same lineup as
Super Nintendo. What I thought. It's just at some point, my brain has shifted into just thinking about the bottom button being the confirm button and the one on the in the middle and on the left being the back button. So I keep hitting the back button instead of the forward button.
Mm. Well, you know that's reversed on Sony, right? The cross and the circle on the PlayStation controller are backwards in the U.S. from the way they are originally designed.
Really?
Because cross is no and circle is yes.
Mm-hmm.
So that B button
is
still the same on Nintendo. They just don't switch it when it comes to the U.S.
Oh, that's fascinating.
Yeah. So it's the same for if you were playing a Japanese PlayStation game, imported, the button layout would be the exact same button layout as it is on the Nintendo.
No, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying they need to switch it or they've done anything wrong. I'm saying my reaction to it was frustration because I wasn't able to remap the button. That said,
I will say that it can be very frustrating when games don't offer a remapping option.
Mm-hmm.
So I can agree with you that it is. Sometimes games, it feels like designers need to kind of get on board with remapping.
No kidding.
Like, let people remap however they feel like it.
I mean,
you find it more often in PC games.
There was remapping on my 64, for Pete's sake. You know, whenever we first got into Doom, it was on a 64.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, and but it's the best we had back then. You know, the truth is that we really didn't have any good mapping and controls for first-person shooters until, well, really it was kind of Bungie that changed it all. And then everything else went, you know, from there. And I'm not a huge Halo fan.
Did Bungie make a good
first-person shooter? I actually hated Halo because it was so slow compared to Doom. I would rather have had the bad graphics and had the good controls. But I digress, because what I'm talking about is something that is designed for dual screen. And this is my next point. One screen is a touch screen, the other screen is not. I know that's because one is HD and one is not, but it still just drives me nuts. I keep trying to touch that top screen for some reason.
Because of the phone.
You know, I think that's probably it, is that since then we've evolved and we've had phones that do this. That said, I don't look at the bottom screen enough. It's supposed to be a pop-up. It's supposed to get in my way. It's supposed to be in-game information. Technically, it's out-of-game information, if you want to use the correct term, but which is a misnomer because it's in the game. But that out-of-game information keeps popping up and giving me the tutorial done on the second screen, the bottom screen, and I'm missing it every single time. So there is a huge literacy problem for me. I found it to be uncomfortable, and I'm not enjoying the hardware. We'll get to the game itself, because we are going to do...
Right. We'll do that roundtable in a few weeks.
And I'm looking forward to that. Earliest. I have some good things to say, and I have some bad things to say, but...
But it's interesting. I guess I'm a bit disappointed sorry for you that you can't enjoy the 3DS hardware.
I don't own one, so I don't feel too broken up about
right,
it.
Right.
There is a game, I think, that uses it really well. It's not a great game, but Star Fox Command, the way it splits up the two screens, mm-hmm. the top screen is all of your action. It's your... it's where you see your fighter. There's mm-hmm. never a reason to feel the need to touch it, because there's no interface there at all. You just see the fighter or the cockpit, sure, depending on your view. The interface is actually on the lower screen, where the map is, which you're already touching, because that's how you pilot the craft. So you're already naturally controlling it from the touchscreen. With the stylus, with your thumb, whatever.
Yeah, okay.
And then all the interfaces, use of bombs, boosts, that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. is all on that anyway, as buttons on your control panel.
Yeah. Doesn't... I want to say Kid Icarus does something similar, doesn't it? Yeah. So it's another one that does something.
Interesting. Kid Icarus, I'd love to try some of those.
Yeah.
To be fair...
I have Kid Icarus Uprising that I could let you borrow.
I haven't played with anything else other than the game itself. I haven't really, messed with the 3D camera or anything like that. But I was disappointed at how clunky I found the actual system itself to be for my old hands.
I'm sorry for your hands. All right,
try playing the original. Like the one I have is an original.
Yeah,
it's small, and after about an hour, it digs into your hands completely.
Yeah,
because it's about this big and a square.
Yeah, I've heard that the best experience is actually in the new 3DS, but I haven't gotten one yet.
Mm.
There's a new version that it has the extra thumbstick, the new 3DS XL, but I don't have it. I just have the regular XL. I like it, but I can understand that there could be some literacy problems, like you're talking about. All right, so for me this week, I've played a couple of games, but the one I want to talk about is Sleeping Dogs. I got the Definitive Edition for PS4.
Just let them lie, Jim.
Yeah. Well, Sleeping Dogs is a game that I did play some on the PC, but this version has all of the DLC and extra additions to it, and it's a game I kind of have wanted to revisit on a console.
Now, this is the failed and aborted game that ended up getting picked up by a different company, right?
I don't know about that. All I know is that it actually got several Game of the Year nominations. It was actually very well received, so I don't know where you get failed from.
Well, because it was supposed to be a genuine sequel. It was supposed to be one of the threes, and I forget it was supposed to be a three, too.
A sequel to what?
Yeah, that's what I don't remember.
I don't know. Anyway, Sleeping Dogs...
I'll look it up while you talk.
Anyway, Sleeping Dogs is it is an open world game similar to a GTA, only it is takes place in Hong Kong, and you are a... Like in many Hong Kong action movies, you are a Hong Kong detective that has gone undercover as part of one of the Chinese or Hong Kong gangs, which of course is related to a triad. I forgot the name. It's like Sunong Yi, I believe, is the name of the gang that you're trying to infiltrate. It's very similar to, like, if you're a fan of Hong Kong action movies, this is like basically hits all of the tropes, has all of the like the violence, but also the same sort of storytelling motifs. It's definitely not a game that I would say branches out very much. Kind of like one of the discussions we had before we started, Will. It's definitely a game that knows what it is and just kind of sticks to that.
Kind of like that.
Yeah, but it's fun. It's actually very fun. And I'm a big fan of open world games. And I'm a fan of GTA, as I've mentioned many times. This game, of course, you're playing as a a good guy, but you're playing as a good guy that has to sometimes be a bad guy because he's undercover. So he's got to do some bad things to eventually catch the good people. So you have multiple missions. Some of your missions are cop-related missions. Some of your missions are triad-related missions. And there's also some of the DLC is interesting. There's DLC where you are essentially the hopping vampire genre, you could say, from Hong Kong movies. Essentially, it's like their version of like a zombie,
mm-hmm.
where it's basically these little vampires that kind of hop around. It's kind of a almost like jokey type thing. And the Mr. Vampire series was big on sort of popularizing that. They made like 5 or 6 of those. But anyway, yeah, like there's a DLC version of that has that kind of storyline. It's not as good as I would have hoped, but it's got that. It has some like Big Trouble in Little China motifs in that one too, where you've got some of the like magician type characters that shoot lightning and that kind of thing. But anyway, I will say it's a fun game. It kind of takes GTA and it adds a couple of interesting spins that I still think I was a little surprised GTA 5 didn't steal. That is the counter system is actually pretty well done. So it allows for you to have some good like acrobatic martial arts style combat. And the other one is that when you're driving, this is a big one I thought GTA was gonna take for GTA 5, never did. Is when you're driving in a car, you can sort of like swerve to the side real quick
with one of
the button presses, and it's kind of allows you almost like a bumper car type thing. But it's great when you're being chased because you can kind of slow down and like sideswipe people and knock them off the road. They can do it. Some of them can do it to you too. So it kind of adds that element. But it's a really fun little mechanic to throw into driving.
So like in Jack and Daxter 2. From like a ways back.
Yeah, I'm not saying it was the first game to do it.
I'm just kidding.
It was the first game to do it. There's been a lot of games that have that sort of.
I'm totally just kidding. Yeah. It's basically just anthropomorphic Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm just saying this is a it's a mechanic that I think really GTA would be. It seems like it would fit well within that theme and never really has gone into.
That's actually a really cool mechanic in Mario Kart Double Dash.
Yeah.
On the GameCube.
Yeah.
That they only had it in that one and it never came back, but it was a really fun little thing you could take advantage of to steal items and knock people off the road. So
we'll have to talk about Double Dash at some point. All of the things that Double Dash did that then were just kind of dropped by the Mario Kart franchise for some weird reason.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's what I've been playing.
It sounds to me like you seem to like Hong Kong action films.
Oh, I do, big time.
You'd probably like then the RPG system, Feng Shui. Mm-hmm. Or they say it's pronounced a number of different ways, but Feng Shui 2 is a fairly recent sort of reboot of the original one.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a tabletop role-playing game that tries to get that sort of cinematic feel of a like kung fu film. So,
cool.
But that's another topic for another day.
Yeah, there's the other like martial art kung fu related RPG, the Gen
mm-hmm.
game that I was hoping that we could play as well.
So I did a fact check.
Yes.
And what I was thinking of was that it was part of the True Crime series, which is correct.
Mm-hmm.
It started out in 2009. It was canceled by Activision in 2011. And it was then picked up by Square Enix. So technically it is a reboot and the first in the series to be done by a different developer,
mm-hmm.
if you want to look at it
yeah.
that way.
Yeah.
But that is what I was thinking.
Cool.
Of.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
Y'all wanted to talk about a game that I have not played called Tragedy Looper. Now,
yes.
Is this related to that horrible time travel movie that I didn't like that came out not too long ago?
No,
that
this
was
is
a tragedy. But,
this is a board game.
Okay.
The Tragedy Looper.
It's one of those in a short list of what I would call role-play fusion board games.
Mm.
Will, you're the one who has run us through it so many times.
Okay.
You want to talk about why you got it and what your experience has been with it?
Well, the funny thing was, I was actually talking to them about if you could make a time travel board game. And then, like, 2 days later, I found this article talking about this game in Japan that was being brought to America in the next month. And the premise is you have up to 4 people playing, but you need a minimum of 2 because one of them is a mastermind who's triggering events that's causing the universe to loop. And then everyone else is playing against him to try and solve what he's doing and prevent it. And the whole game is laid out similar to those old activity puzzle books that have the logic graph where it's like Susie did her homework, but Tommy copied off of Billy. But if Susie worked with Billy, and then you have to figure out who did what to find out who stole
the dog
or something.
Oh, yeah, they give you like 4 points or something, and then you have to take all those and figure out like exactly how it happened chronologically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like that, because the game gives you a list of pre-made plots and subplots, And there's different sets of characters with different roles within the game. Hmm. And as you play the game, you have to figure out which NPCs have which roles and why. Hmm. And why the mastermind is doing certain things and what's causing each loop to trigger.
Do you think this is almost like a slightly based on Clue, like a time travel Clue type
it's
thing?
Like a... It's Clue on steroids as far as deduction is concerned, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And I don't know if that would help deduction, being on steroids, but...
No.
Maybe. My personal favorite thing about it is that there's not a single random element in the game.
No.
Everyone has the exact same hand except for the mastermind, but all the hands are known. You don't draw, you just have it, and you play cards in advance to determine what you're going to do for the turn. Every single one of the NPCs that's on the board has the same abilities... Every game, depending on which NPCs are played. The roles are always the same, the plots are always the same. You just have to figure out which ones are in play that game. The time travel part of it comes into, as you play the game, the players are developing, they're placing goodwill counters on NPCs to trigger abilities. Hmm. When the conditions for a loop are met, a specific role dies, or you reach the end but you didn't befriend this person and that's the end of it, or there's an incident in the hospital and something triggers, all of that resets. NPCs go back to where they were, all goodwill tokens are removed, special abilities are given back, and you have to start over. It's a, like, maybe it's roleplay fusion, but the one time I was playing, the guy running it wasn't doing a lot of the roleplay aspect to it, so it was strictly a logic board game.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So you can kind of go either way. I like throwing a little bit of story into it, because it's built around it. There's actually... the scenarios, which can all be custom built. You can actually build... It has rules for building your own scenarios for the game. Giving it... Not unlimited, but enough that... I've had the game for like 6 months or something now, and I've played 6-7 times.
Very nice. So. And there's actually a new expansion coming out, as
yes.
far as I'm aware.
Yeah, they've... Really? There's actually two of them.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because they released 2 sets of 10, which include new plots, new subplots, and some new NPCs. Mm-hmm. But they bundled them together and are shipping them as one in the U.S.
I bet there's also... I'd be curious to see if there's kind of an official list of fan-made scenarios that have been published. Because I'm sure there's a whole bunch out there, but you never know. Like, you know, person A and person B might be on totally different levels as far as design sense.
I've had some trouble finding those, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. People don't seem to be posting them. I know that there's a lot of...
It's a very niche game.
They've
so.
Been done in... There's been some in Japan that have been released.
Cool.
Like, people have posted those, but... I can't read Japanese, so...
Oh, yeah. Well, have you checked BoardGameGeek.com?
I haven't seen any on there. That's
really?
The problem.
Oh, that's like, shocking,
I haven't
actually.
Seen... The main thing I've seen there is some people reskinned all the cards, so it looks like Persona 4.
Yeah, that's a pretty standard thing. I love that community.
Yeah, it's...
Well, the game itself is by Z-Man, which...
It's by Bacafire.
Oh,
it's
is it?
Translated by Z-Man.
Well, that's what I mean.
Yeah,
it's
yeah, published in the
it's
U.S.
It's published in the U.S. Yeah. By Z-Man.
Okay,
that,
I just wanted to... Sure.
Fair
give
enough.
Credit where credit is due.
No, you're absolutely right.
We're all about street cred on this
right.
podcast.
I'm just saying, I have a lot of respect for Z-Man. They tend to find unusual games, older games, games that can be reskinned, games that can be republished, that kind of a thing, and do that. Like one of our also mutual favorites is the Tales of the Arabian Nights series, which, Z-Man
it's fantastic.
Sort of reskinned that one, and it's got wonderful new... Gloriousness.
Is that the one that board game? The board game Tales from is that the
it's
one?
It's a choose your own adventure story as a board game.
Yeah, I played that one. Yeah, that was actually a really interesting game.
Yeah.
We actually found out there's some stuff they dropped from the original, which makes it slightly more interesting.
Really?
Mm-hmm. But they dropped it for I guess you'd say the ability for people to just pick it up and start playing.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
It makes the game simpler without those rules.
That's right.
Oh, okay.
But the other rules
it's
add things like a little bit of PvP, a little bit more narrative interaction, where you can actually rather than just reading from the book. Throw your own stories in for better rewards.
Yeah. Caravans. Caravan roll.
Huh. Yeah.
And you can actually set it up so that you'll have 5 people playing and 3 of them have different win conditions. So you have people playing the standard game, some people playing the quest-based game, and then others playing the caravan game where their goal is to make as much money as possible.
Yep. We picked it up for about $50 on eBay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. Came out in the 80s.
And now, the official one-tweet RPG of the week.
All right. So let's do the one-tweet RPG of the week. This is actually one that I came up with, so I'll go ahead and talk about it, explain what it was I was talking about it. It says, hit the random button on tvtropes.org 3 times to create your character, then once each new scene. So the idea behind it is that tvtropes.org has a random button, which is the coolest thing in the world for a page like tvtropes.org. So this kind of made me think, hey, you know...
For people who don't know, what is TV Tropes?
Well, okay. So TV Tropes is a wiki. It's a catalog of what some would call tricks of the trade for writing fiction, and others would call absolutely terrible catch-all, beaten-to-death stereotypes for the trade of writing fiction. So, for example, if I was to go ahead and hit it right now, got it up on my iPad, so I'll just go ahead and hit the button. Boop, there we go. Plot-based voice cancellation. Okay, so this is the idea behind this particular trope, is plot-based voice cancellation. Sometimes one line can change everything for the characters as well as the audience, so often, if that line has to come up early on, it will be canceled out by some other noise, such as a truck passing or a plane taking off, right? So what you've got is, as one of your character's abilities, plot-based voice cancellation, where you can use that skill as one of your abilities.
Sounds like a more useful GM skill. But
you may be right there, actually. All right, the next one is most definitely not accompanying us. The hero and his five-man band are gearing up for the final battle, heading for the airport for the latest trip to the Temple of Doom, or taking the ransom money to meet the kidnappers, whatever, whatever. But the hero tells him or her in no uncertain terms that there's no way they're going to be allowed to go along. So it's that idea of my little brother's definitely not coming, but, you know, he ends up, like, saving the day or something like that. So you're the character who is told that you're most definitely not accompanying us. That's the second trope. Oh, and probably in that moment whenever you're told that, the truck goes by. So you're definitely not... There we go.
And because you didn't hear, he came along as a stowaway.
Right, and my third one, having just created this character, is something about a rose. Ooh. What accessory could you possibly add up to more sex appeal than a rose? It allows you to show your sensitive side and look really cool. So there you go. It could be weaponized. It could be a petal storm. It could be... whatever, you know. But now my character has a rose.
And now the one each scene, is that something that you add to your character each scene? Okay, or is that an element that's introduced each scene?
Everyone's done this independently, right? They've created their characters with their three tropes. Mm-hmm. And so now the GM will go ahead and create a scene based on a new trope.
Okay.
An achievement test of destiny. They call this a test, but it's not just a test. It's the test. It's the one thing that will judge every aspect of your character. It will tell your limits, your future, your fate, all spelled out in little black dots of number two pencil on a Scantron sheet. It's the achievement test that will decide your destiny.
So Insurgent.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. Standardized exam, you know, it's the...
I think you just made Tuxedo Mask. I'm pretty sure you made Tuxedo Mask.
So the point is, you decide how many scenes you want to do in advance, or you keep going until there's some kind of story resolution.
Until everyone just gets sick of it.
Yeah, and so you would start up and you'd say, you're sitting in an achievement test. Mm-hmm. And then everyone can use their skills to try to overcome that... difficulty which was created by the trope until you're done.
The answer is
right.
Yeah.
And the answer is
believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then we like to talk about the other stuff.
I've recently watched all of Better Call Saul, which is a spinoff / prequel series for Breaking Bad, Vince Gilligan's Breaking Bad.
There's a prequel series for Breaking Bad.
Yes.
How did I not know about this?
It may not have had enough promotion. I know AMC did promote it quite a bit, but I feel like they didn't maybe advertise on other stations as much as maybe they're used to. I don't know.
Wow. Something I noticed is I only ever heard about it on social media, like when it was announced.
It had kind of a push on
there. There were like no trailers, no previews or anything until like right before it came out.
I actually liked that. And in fact, as I was watching through it, I intentionally tried to avoid watching the trailers. Well, actually, I'll get into that. Let me start off and give you a little bit of overview of the series.
Yeah,
so,
please.
Saul is this sort of like shady lawyer character in Breaking Bad that is sort of this like he said like the used car salesman of lawyers type character,
mm-hmm.
Where he's very animated, played by Bob Odenkirk, and he's very like you know, over animated, kind of will do anything for his clients, but he also lives by, he does have like rules, like he lives by legal rules technically, but like he stretches it, you know. He's the
lawyer with cheesy TV commercials, yes. Saying like, "Have you been hurt in a car wreck?" You know.
Yes.
And,
yeah, like the Texas Hammer, based on like,
I was not going to name names in fear of getting sued. But,
well, we're not even saying his name. That's his like, you know, tagline.
Well, we clearly know who we're talking about. Anyway.
Yes. Yeah, I'm sure he's
going. I'm the Oklahoma Tornado. Yeah.
Exactly. So the fun, but this series, Better Call Saul, is really about. Before Saul was Saul Goodman, but when he was still Jimmy Smith, Jimmy, what was it? Oh, I can't believe I'm blanking on the last name. Not for the last
name. So that's not his
McGill.
Real...
McGill, yeah.
That's not
Jimmy
his real
McGill.
Name?
No. His real name is Jimmy McGill. And this story is about him and his early life and his struggles to be a lawyer and to be a serious lawyer, to be taken seriously. And, you know, his brother is actually a very successful lawyer, or was a very successful lawyer. And it's very interesting because we had talked earlier about how quickly the pilot moves in Breaking Bad from a character perspective, you know, getting into the meth cooking very quickly from being a, you know, high school chemistry teacher that seems to be a very upstanding moral citizen to meth cook in one episode.
Yeah, I kind of had a problem with that, actually.
Right. But in Saul, in Better Call Saul, Jimmy, his character arc... He has a very clear character arc that takes the entire season to run through, and there's a lot of, he has a chance to be the Saul that you expect him to be, but he doesn't do it, and he has a chance to be that kind of that person, and he doesn't do it constantly. And then there's this moment at the end of the series where it seems like maybe he's going in that direction, and even then you're not sure. So they do a lot of like playing with little hints of, oh hey, is he now going to be the Saul Goodman that we know? Nope. You know, kind of like a lot of like bait and switch type thing throughout the series. So the reason why I wanted to bring this up is because I do believe that Vince Gilligan does character drama, some of the best character drama, if not the best character drama in a dramatic television series. And the reason that I want to talk about it on a gaming podcast is just sort of to ask this question: how games might a game like because it's a, yes, games have. Strong character. There's games with strong characters and character development, but the focus is still on the story. Whereas with Gilligan, in Breaking Bad, and actually even much more so in Better Call Saul, it's really not about the story. It's about the character and the character's arc, and that's what the entire show is about.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, while thinking of it, I struggle to think of a game that's really. I don't think there is a game that is. This is a game about this character and their development and the character struggles and the character arc, and not about the story. There is no narrative thrust, really. I mean, it's there, but it's only there through the lens of this character arc. It's only about how it affects the
sure,
character.
Sure, yeah.
So what... And if you say Sonic the Hedgehog 2...
Oh, no.
Because you know that's not true.
I promise I won't. Though it could be. no... This is going to put me on stage, but have you played any visual novels? Not kinetic novels, visual novels.
I have, yeah.
Those, like, full-on visual novels, that's typically the focus. Because what you end up with is you end up with multiple different characters, and the story is not always the central point of it.
But my
depending
problem,
on which way you
I sort of see what you're talking about with visual novels, but see, my problem with that is I would hesitate to say a visual novel... are really video games. Like, they're kind of their own thing. They're, like, I mean, you even called them visual novels. Like, that's what they are.
It's clearly interactive media, but it's
sure,
not necessarily
but
a
but they're
video
not
game.
Really a name. They're not really a game. They're
It depends on which ones.
Novel.
It depends on which ones you're playing. Because some of them are what they've subgenred as kinetic novels, where it is just you interact with the story kind of almost like a choose-your-own-adventure, whereas others actually consist of how you... play the game,
mm-hmm.
does more than just get responses and give you story outputs. It actually gives you marketable and traceable stats
mm-hmm.
and equipment that you use at different points. Some of them even include, there was one that I played that actually had a hex-based space strategy combat in between the visual novels.
Yeah, there are weird forms that have that. Like the Lone
yeah.
Wolf series is a series of books that has that.
Yeah.
Right, but, okay, so what would you say is a good example of a visual novel in your estimation that you feel is very strong on very strong focus on the character arc and not and but not so much of a focus on the, it's like not really narrative focus, it's focused on the character.
I would say maybe the better distinction would be character versus plot.
Yeah. Because, I'm sorry, plot. I would argue that a lot of
better stories are actually character driven inherently.
No, I agree, and that's what I'm talking about.
I don't think those elements are at odds. I think that what you're saying is that Better Call Saul is a story about the characters.
Yes, but I'm not saying
the plot is intrinsically about character development.
Yes. I'm not necessarily saying that there are odds. I'm just saying there's a different focus there. And I'm saying that it is a focus that is like you rarely see that in games. Is the point that I'm making.
Well, and I think that's probably because of the nature of the mechanics of the game,
correct.
The interactive nature of running around and hitting robots with a stick.
Right. Exactly.
Because my example is actually Enslaved Odyssey to the West, which is it's got RPG elements and it's got a journey. It's got all these things. It's based on Chinese mythology set in the post-apocalypse.
Yeah.
I absolutely love the love story. I love the characterization and the development of the round characters. But at the same time, ultimately what it's about is I need to get from point A to point B. It's a completely linear platformer.
Right.
In 3D space that is all about hitting robots with my energy stick.
Mm-hmm.
You might say Fire Emblem kind of fits that mold because their stories tend to be fairly straightforward. But the more interesting story moments, I think, come from the character moments, especially the support conversations and stuff like that, where you're getting a lot of interesting character development. And the meaning in the stories very clearly comes from the characters and not from, okay, a war is happening, a war is ending, and now a new threat's coming and a new threat's ending. It really is about the characters.
Well, something like Fallout, you can make that same argument.
Yeah.
This is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
So, at the time of recording, it is now 5 days until the release of Metal Gear Solid 5.
No, it's not.
I jumped quickly back into the future, and now I'm back here in the past.
Okay. Oh, okay, cool. Thank
you. So I bring news from the future. So,
at the time of recording.
Yes, of course. At the time of the future, it is 5 days until the release of Metal Gear Solid 5, and the hype is very real.
Mm-hmm.
There's a funny little meme that's kind of broken out. I think in one of the more recent release trailers that Kojima put together, he had a phrase, V, meaning the V45, the Roman numeral, has come to, period. Basically, it is now here. And so people have been putting up all these photos that contain a V-shape somewhere in there. So an example is that little duck clock from Metal Gear Solid 4. It's the hands of the clock are forming a sort of V-shape.
Mm-hmm.
And this is Hideo Kojima's retweeting all of these. A whole bunch of people are doing them, but he's tweeting the funnier ones. There's a picture of a literal snake, not a solid or a liquid or any other snake, sticking out its tongue, and the forked tongue is forming a V, mm-hmm. you know. There's a picture of eggs and chips and some bacon in the shape of a V. And then there's a flying V of geese. And it just goes on and on. Another really funny one is Raiden from Metal Gear Solid 2 doing his little cartwheel flip.
Yes.
The part where he was naked. So his legs are up in midair forming a V.
Yeah.
So just really funny stuff on here. So I just wanted to go ahead and comment on it quickly on this funny little emergent gamer culture meme that has emerged because of Metal Gear Solid 5. So, V has come to.
It's time to hashtag get wrecked with some talk about competitive multiplayer games.
This is something that Doc and I have been looking forward to as big fans of the card game Hearthstone. The Grand Tournament expansion is now out, and one of the biggest new mechanics in that is what's called Inspire. It is a thing that happens to a card when you use your hero power, which is something that every character has, and it varies from class to class. So, for example, a mage, at any time, you can pay 2 mana to shoot a fireball for 1 damage at somebody. And so whenever you were to do that as the mage, you would have any characters with Inspire trigger their effects, and it can be anything from gain extra attack power this turn or spawn a new character.
Such as a Murloc.
Yeah. There's a Paladin, actually. A Paladin card. It's a Murloc Knight, I think, is the name of the card, and if you Inspire it, it spawns a random Murloc, which is awful.
I'm all over that. The fact that there were new Murlocs, I was just like, yeah, okay, I'm in.
Yeah. So, so far, really good impressions of the expansion. It seems like there's some interesting new cards, interesting new strategies, and I'm interested to see how the meta is going to be affected. I am pleasantly surprised that so far And this is the first time I've been around for a big shift in the meta like this. But I'm pleasantly surprised that it's more like people are integrating cards into existing strategies rather than just totally wiping out everything that came before and saying, these are all the new cards, they're awesome and great and overpowered, and we're only going to use these. That has not been the case so far. So good job to Blizzard for having a well-integrated expansion.
True dat. And also...
Oh god, the nightmares. Oh. They never end.
Wait. Oh, God, okay. Oh, I can't do it right now. That's like a mixture of like Snarf and Thundercats and like Chewbacca or something.
I can't even do it. There should be like a Chewy Murloc.
Chewy Murloc?
Yeah, anyway. That was Get Wrecked.
Is that enough appetizers? Are we ready for our meat?
I think we're ready for our meat. I think if you overcook a Murloc, you get a Chewy Murloc. Okay, our meaty topic for today.
Only if you use salt water.
You salt water
after midday.
Yeah. Well, no, salt water taffy. It's just. Yeah. I don't know anything about cooking. Don't ask me.
Okay.
So this episode, our meaty topic is time travel theories and possibly a game that we could use to fit a realistic time travel theory. So we've brought in an expert on time travel, straight from the future, or is it the past? Well,
we're not sure at this point.
We're not sure.
Will might be different. He was the exception, but we're fairly incompetent time travelers.
There we go. Yes.
You just have to focus on what your linearity is. Mm-hmm. That's it. The rest of it doesn't matter.
Pro tips.
So what is your theory of time travel then? Or do you have a theory that you feel is like the most realistic? Or maybe realistic is not the right word.
So personally, it's a space. You look at, I think I've explained this to you before, but you look at three-dimensional space, we all exist within a three-dimensional space, and we have the ability to move through a three-dimensional space, but the place where I'm standing does not stop being that place when I move to another one. Mm-hmm. Time is the same way. Yesterday still is yesterday, tomorrow is still tomorrow, even when I'm in the present, even as I'm moving through it. I can't control that. But where I am now, and before I finish this sentence, and after I finish this sentence, and before I started this sentence, is still ongoing in that instant. And so all of that happens, for lack of a better term, simultaneously in a separate plane. So once you move up to a second plane, you're able to move through all of that equally because it all happens at the same time. It all affects everything at the same time. Just as a 3D space does. It's not the most popular because it doesn't... It's really hard to use in, like, movies and stuff. Loaf of bread time travel or stream time travel is more popular because you can go back and do whatever you want. But
now, explain the explain string and loaf of bread.
Stream, mm-hmm. Like a river.
Oh, stream, okay.
Stream time travel is a split universe. Mm-hmm. It's different from different world line. Things like the original Terminator movie... where they go back, they change it, it's permanent change, and that is the world. That's where you're stuck with. It's more like...
Back to Future 2?
Maybe. But he's actually stuck on that, and he can move back to where he was. There's a difference. Stream time travel is more like Echo, where when you go back, you split a river, and so there's the original timeline, and then there's the one that you're on.
No, that's exactly what happens in Back to Future 2. That's exactly how it's explained, at least. Here's the timeline, and then he does the little...
Biff went back, and they found the cane, and he changed the timeline. And yeah. When they went forward, they ended up going forward into an alternate timeline.
Right, because they could only go forward into the timeline that had happened from the split. They couldn't go... Like, the previous timeline
right,
no
but
longer
did the
existed.
Other time, so that's
it
the
did,
difference.
But in the past.
That's the difference. He said the previous timeline no longer existed. In a split timeline, they both still exist. That's the difference. In one of them... Only one of them exists. It's a new world line. Things like Steins Gate, apparently Back to the Future, all of those, when you change it, it goes down that new path, and that's the only one that exists.
That makes sense.
Whereas in things like Echo, it describes it as being a river that splits it, and so you get two paths that are both occurring.
So it's like...
Zelda timeline.
Yeah.
So you have two alternate timelines at the same
time. Yes, and they both continue to exist. The difference is that you have two versions of yourself in the new one that affected
it. But hold on. Like, the problem with the split timeline theory is that shouldn't you have, like, infinite splits? Like, why do you just have two splits?
Because you only perceive the two splits. There are probably infinite splits, but it's based on the number of times you time travel. I can't, like, I would demonstrate this with my hands, but you can't hear it over the sound. Maybe I could draw it for you later. In that kind of a scenario, what you end up having is a line where you are, you have two lines of time. One for you and one for what everyone else recognizes. You're both going at a set rate. When you travel, they continue on. That history continues. You loop back around to another point, and when you cross over, so basically your loop hits the original timeline, it breaks off and carries through and starts a new one that's parallel.
Yeah. So in other words, there's like an alternate dimension where you're not there anymore.
And so we get that in Dragon Ball Z does that with Trunks. Did you ever see Dragon Ball Z?
I believe so.
It does that where it's like
I haven't seen it, but
when he goes back to the he comes from the future to stop Frieza because Goku couldn't stop him because he gets heart disease and collapses. So he comes back from the it's not from Frieza, it's from like the androids. And then so when he returns to the future though, his future timeline still exists. His future timeline where the androids destroyed the world because Goku couldn't stop them. That timeline still exists, even though he went back to the past to prevent it from happening. He prevented it from happening in one timeline, but not in...
Which is interesting to me, because if you're sort of assuming that both timelines exist simultaneously, then it's kind of up to the time traveler to decide which timeline they want to live with. And so you can kind of be selfish and be like, you know what? I went back in time so that I could live in the better timeline.
Right.
While I leave all my family and friends back in the crappy timeline.
I mean, he stays until his mission is until the full mission is complete, and then he returns to the future. And then, to his timeline. Mm-hmm. And then when he returns to his timeline, of course, he's, in Dragon Ball style, he's improved, he's trained enough, so now he can also stop the bad guys in the future.
Actually, gives me an interesting idea for
other timelines.
A time travel story about people who actually immigrate between timelines, It's better in this version of America. Let's all go to that version of America or something like that.
I could have sworn, wasn't there... Oh, geez. There was a series that I watched. And what was it where the exact same thing happens? It was in it's a comic book. And it was... Oh, geez. What was that called? It was a DC comic storyline. I want to say it happens in the Future's End storyline. Did you ever read that? It was somewhat recent.
In
DC,
which?
DC
yeah,
comics.
I don't really read.
Oh, okay, so essentially, it was this event, and essentially, what happened was the interesting part of it. There was a lot of stuff that wasn't interesting, but essentially, what happens is there's this because DC has the multiverses, but in this particular one, and one of the multiverses was going to be destroyed or some BS, and so the people try to escape to a different universe or different multiverse or what have you, a different universe from the multiverse. Which they do, and now they're immigrants to that multiverse, and they can't return to their own because their own has been destroyed. Mm-hmm. But the people that are in this one don't, there's a lot of hatred for them because they're doubles of a lot of different people that are still existing.
Uh-huh.
So they have to register as people from the other Earth. And
that sounds cool, actually.
So yeah, it's the concept itself is great. It's executed terribly, but the concept is really cool.
So all we really need to do to fix the the environmental problems we're having is just sort of move humanity to an Earth where humanity hasn't existed up until the point where we arrive.
No, but then we get dinosaurs, and there probably would be anthropomorphic dinosaurs.
Actually, that was the plot of Terra Nova.
God, there's another.
It wasn't
that
they went back in time;
cool,
they went to an alternative timeline,
right?
Okay.
Which I always thought. Well, first of all, I wanted a second season because I actually liked that show a lot. Yeah. But I thought it had a lot of potential. Yeah, I thought that the trick to the whole thing, because the whole idea behind it was we're going to go back and we're going to colonize because we've already proven that we can't possibly mess with this. It's a different timeline. Because we put a beacon out here, and we anchored it down, and it's not here in the future, so it can't be. And I think at the end of the series, what should have happened is that thing should have been destroyed. But they were already there and planted and had a foothold, and they had to stay. So that it actually did prove that they were still in their own timeline.
Weren't there hints that they had that was still the their timeline or something like that?
No, they never got around to it. They might have had plans to, but it didn't happen.
So we've covered stream. How about a loaf of bread?
So loaf of bread is... It's your cherry picker version of time travel, which a lot of shows do it. They kind of prefer it because it's really easy to use. If you look at time as almost like the number line in basic elementary math, you have slices of time in a large loaf. Wherever you are, you can jump to any individual slice. This is what really ticks me off about most time travel stories, because they treat it like this without relativism, which would be, all right, I'm traveling back 50 years, but I'm locked. So I can only travel relative to how much time I've spent from when I left. They don't do that. They just give you, I can travel whenever I want. I can cherry pick around. So instead of developing this sense of urgency, they're 50 years in the past. They have all the time in the world to do whatever they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't treat it that way. They just assume that since there should be a rush in the story, mm-hmm. they have to get back by a certain time, which leads into relativistic, all right, I've gone back 50 years, but I spent 5 hours here, so when I go back, I'm going to be 5 hours further than when I left.
Okay.
Just kind of silly.
Mm-hmm.
Loaf of bread or a slice of bread doesn't follow that because you can just cherry pick. I jump back here to the past, I jump to here, I jump to here, and it doesn't really address whether or not there's consequences to what you do,
mm-hmm.
which is why it's used so often. You can just kind of ignore the consequences of time travel. You can just go where you want.
Is that the one that a lot of times, I mean, won't they use it a lot in shows where they're going back almost like tourists to
yeah.
the other time? So it's like they can't change anything big, and technically they could. Maybe they're changing something in the sense that, like, they're going to a store and they're buying something that maybe it's not going to be there for someone else to buy, but it doesn't matter because it's not really a historical event per se.
That one is actually more of a...
I guess Doctor Who kind of does something similar to that as well.
Depends on which Doctor. Or yeah. I guess
like, you
say
time
locks, right.
Or what do they call them? Like, not the time locks.
That one's a time lock. But it depends on which writer. For instance, Nicholas Briggs, who writes a lot of the stuff for the Eighth Doctor,
right.
does a web of time concept,
mm-hmm.
where every node for time is interconnected. If you break one, the web still works, and so it holds together. They actually have a set story in one of the dramas. This is a little spoilerific, but I'm not going to tell you which one. So, where they run into a military leader that's horrible. History regards them as a horrible, horrible person who did all these terrible things. And one of his companions convinces the guy, you shouldn't do this, and so he doesn't. And the Doctor steps in and is like, oh, this is not going to be good. Someone is going to fill those shoes. The guy who corrected him goes in and has to do everything the guy did. He ends up in that position, and not by choice, but because some things need to be done, and he's forced to do some of them. So rather than it being that horrible general, it's him.
Wasn't there... I could have sworn there was a Philip K. Dick short story or novel where it's very similar to that with Nazis.
Probably.
And, like, he had to be Hitler, or one of, like, Hitler's... Because, like, something related to the time... Like, he went back to stop Hitler, but he couldn't stop him because he had to, like, he had to become him for some reason. I forget. It's
they turned
like
it
that.
Into a new Twilight Zone episode, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does that sound familiar to you?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. There's also an old Twilight Zone episode, I think it was old Twilight Zone, where the guy was, he had to become Elvis because he just found Elvis and accidentally killed him. and the end of the episode is like, well, King, I hope I've done you justice. As he dies on the toilet. I mean, it's like, what?
So wait, are you serious? That actually...
Yeah, yeah, happened? That's an episode.
Is that a new Twilight
episode? I don't remember. It's gotta be, because otherwise it wouldn't have fit.
The whole going back and killing Hitler thing reminds me of the Red Alert series.
Yes, yeah.
I think it was Einstein, actually, that goes back and assassinates Hitler.
Something like, yeah, I think it is. Like,
yeah.
I don't know if he necessarily did it, but he invented a time machine to do it.
He invented the time machine, yeah, right.
Yeah, which is, I mean, essentially the same thing, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So hold on. So what about, are you familiar with Quantum Leap?
Yes, I love Quantum Leap.
Yeah, so the time travel in that, what is that considered?
Because
I always thought that was an interesting concept for time travel.
Alternate past.
Okay.
So it's kind of similar to like the branching paths, but when you jump back, he can just change stuff. It's
but only within his own lifetime. It's like that you know, he has that restriction. He can only
right.
go back as far as his own lifetime.
It's a relativistic.
Kind of, yeah.
So he's got a limited span of jumps. He's got a limited distance he can go, that kind
mm-hmm.
of thing.
That had to do with quantum physics within the fiction of that
yeah.
science,
correct.
Though. Because since you can't do it, the only way that you can travel is mentally. And it was a one-off because what it's supposed to be is within the context of your own body. And so they did the one-off as somebody else's body... And you're really a hologram, and you're really all these things. It was very strange.
But remember, like the person that he's exchanging with goes into his body.
That's right.
So they have that whole episode in like the last season.
There's a quantum exchange,
right? They had that whole episode on the last season where they bring like some serial killer or something. He's in the body of a serial killer, or murderer, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's now in Sam's body in the future, and he has this
yeah.
whole like they try to make it, you know, action. That whole last season was, like, action-y nonsense.
That pseudoscience done right actually was seen in the butterfly effect. all three, yes, three movies.
I remember really enjoying the first Butterfly Effect film.
Did you see the alternate ending?
I did.
I liked it. I thought it was fantastic.
I actually didn't like
the alternate ending?
No. Maybe I'm just a sucker for happy endings, but... Actually, I will say, because the thing is, when I watched the movie the first time, I didn't know I was watching the movie, the version with the alternate ending, so I saw the version with the alternate ending the first time.
Oh, I see.
And that was the only ending that I knew existed. Mm. And I actually really enjoyed the movie, but I thought... This ending is not only just a downer, but it's also very fatalistic, which I just didn't agree with.
That's true.
I didn't like the, there's nothing he can do, so he must, like, choke himself out as a baby.
Right.
Or as a fetus, or whatever. Yeah. Concept. That he was able to do that also kind of came across as a little nonsensical. Because he chokes himself with his, like, umbilical cord or something like this. Have you seen Butterfly?
No, I haven't seen any of them.
It's worth... I mean, I would recommend the first one. But to be fair, I haven't seen the other two. I just had heard bad things, so I didn't watch them. So I won't rip on them too much.
But the science is solid.
But the first one I thought was actually a good movie. So I enjoyed it.
Well, I should say the time travel theory is consistent.
It's an interesting time travel theory. So essentially, how does it work? Like, he has to watch... Something like he has to watch a home movie of himself, or what is it?
He has to
read something that he wrote at that time.
Yeah,
right?
and he stares at a picture. It's done differently depending on the movie, actually. But what it comes down to is he blacked out during those times and doesn't remember them. And those are the, call them windows of opportunity that he can jump back to. But which one's the cause and which one's the effect? That's the
right
question.
And that they play with that, too. Uh-huh. And it's this whole thing where, like, he gets older and it's... He had had all of these blackouts throughout his life, and he didn't know why he was having them. And then at some point he realizes why he's having them, because he starts to be able to go back into his own past.
Right.
But they also have that restriction where it just, at least in the first movie, where it seems like he's going back, like, linearly. In order to stop what
a little further back.
Right. In order to stop what he had done, he has to go a little further back, because he can't go... Because he already had used up that space to do whatever he had done. So he does all of these things where... It just keeps making his life worse and worse. Actually, in one of them, he makes his life is like basically perfect, but he messes it up somehow. Like, I think he accidentally kills someone. Isn't that right? Like, the one where everything is basically perfect, and then except for, like, one of his friends is kind of a jerk and, like, gets into a fight with him, and he ends up accidentally killing him, and now, like, he's going to go to prison for the rest of his life or something. So he's like, I'll go back and fix this. And then after that moment, everything is horrible. And everything that he does, he's like, he makes himself a paraplegic at one point.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, he makes, like, his, like, this girl, like, I guess, I don't want to say girlfriend or what, because
it's
different
it was all
in
about,
every storyline.
It was all about the girl.
Yeah, it was all about the girl. But, I mean, he makes her, like, this whore, like, she was, like, a crazy drug addict hooker or something, some weird thing like that. And then, like, one of his best friends in school was then, like, this guy who didn't like him at all, didn't even know who he was, and just weird things like that would keep happening. But it was an interesting time travel concept. I guess you haven't seen the film.
No, I haven't. I've missed that one.
It's worth checking out, though, just for the time travel concept alone, because I can't think of another time it's been used before.
Falls under Backstep.
Okay, Backstep.
Yeah. So things like 7 Days. What was that other one I listed there? Omega 13. That's a looser. That's from Galaxy Quest.
Okay.
But no, like. 7 Days was the same basic principle. He could jump back, but only 7 days. And he's the only one who remembers any of it.
That was a great show.
I do remember that show now.
Yep.
Yeah, that was actually a really cool concept.
Mm-hmm.
I actually thought that was really neat.
It just didn't last very long.
No.
So.
The thing I loved about it is there was an organization, basically the government, supporting him. And so as long as they heard the code phrase, they were like, okay, you've got the full support of the government now.
Yeah.
What do you want?
That is actually one of the other series that does the looping event and does it well.
Right.
But nobody relates that. It's always jump to Groundhog Day.
Well, what about Journeyman? Do you remember Journeyman? That was a short-lived series that was, to me, a modern version of Quantum Leap that was done brilliantly. But he actually did jump into his own body.
Journeyman?
Journeyman.
What was that one?
The name of it was Journeyman. What? Check that one out. I don't even know if it's available.
Is it a television series?
Yeah, it was a television series. It had one season. The best thing about it was the story arc between him and his wife, where she was like, you're crazy. I don't believe you. This is not happening. And by the end of the season, it changes. Like, it evolves. And it's really cool.
So what other models are there for time travel?
Well, there's one of my favorites, which is toroidal, where no matter what you do, you can't affect the past. This is actually more of a scientific concept than it is, because it doesn't really show up in cinema. Mm-hmm.
That's Bill and Ted.
Not so much.
No?
Because it is literally, you cannot affect. The example that they give is, you get a gun that is certified to fire, super accurate. There's no way it will miss. You go back in time, you try to shoot Hitler, you will miss. The gun will jam, the gun will misfire, you will just breeze. You can go back carrying a knife and stab him, and the knife will bend. Because the universe is shaped in such a way that you cannot change the past.
Yeah, that actually comes up in another, to use another comic book reference, but there's actually a comic story that in the Booster Gold, short-lived Booster Gold series, that I thought, that does the same sort of thing, where Booster is a time traveler, or becomes a time traveler, takes over for Rip Hunter, and he tries to prevent two very key events inside DC's history, and literally similar, something, just everything that he tries, even though it seems like he's got the perfect way to do it, it never works. And one of the events is when the Joker cripples Barbara Gordon, Batgirl, and she becomes Oracle. He tries to go back and stop the Joker. You would think, given the sort of abilities that Booster has, and because he has all this future technology and time travel, that he would be able to stop it. But in every way, like, something happens that prevents him from doing it. Basically, it's like Joker's almost, like, invincible. He always, like, loses in some way. And then the other one is the killing of his best friend, Blue Beetle. And the same sort of deal. He tries to go back and stop Max Lord from killing Ted, and it never works.
My only question for that would be, because it sounds mm-hmm. right, are there any ramifications of his actions? Does anything in his present change?
No, except for in one of the cases, actually, the Barbara Gordon one, there is actually, and maybe this changes it, but I think they just threw it in as like a fun Easter egg thing, where essentially, somehow, one of the pictures that Joker took of Barbara Gordon during the whole, like, you know, crippling her, and like, there's this whole thing where essentially it's supposed to be very sadistic.
Right,
like, he forces Jim Gordon, her father, to watch as he, like, snaps pictures of her lying there, like, bleeding out without any clothes on, that kind of thing. But anyway, so, like, in one of those pictures, Booster Gold is there in the picture, who he also gets the same treatment from the Joker in one of his failed attempts, and somehow that picture gets, like, Batman gets that picture, but, like, holds on to it this entire time, and, like, saves it just for this one moment, because he's trying to prove a point to Booster that you can't change the past.
So it's never been seen until he gets back.
Yes.
Okay, then yeah, it's still
And
funny.
It never exists until he gets back. It's
well,
kind of
do
like
you
how
see
it,
that it never exists?
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's you don't know. That's what I'm
okay.
saying. It's
if
like,
you don't know, then yeah. But otherwise, it would fall under the
It's actually
branching
I guess,
paths.
Actually, it's implied that it, I guess it's implied that it did exist. I don't know.
Yeah, what that theory makes me wonder, too, is, like, you know, going back to, like, the not being able to shoot or stab Hitler thing. You know, because we are mass, we are, you know, a bunch of molecules put together into a human, you know, there was gas wherever I would have been standing back then. And so maybe it's just the idea that we can't time travel because literally if I was to go back in time, I couldn't exist there because I didn't exist there.
You couldn't displace whatever, like, matter was there, essentially,
yeah.
is what you're saying.
There's actually a short story about that. Mm. I cannot remember the name of it.
Mm.
It has less to do with time travel and more to do with stopping time.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, when they stop it, they can't move.
Mm-hmm.
Because if they do, it will hurt them.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every single blade of grass they step on is immobile,
mm-hmm.
so their knives just going straight through their feet.
Oh, gotcha.
You can't really push the air out of the way because it can't move.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't even breathe it.
Yeah, I was going to ask, could they
and
breathe?
And that's the thing. Like, it's very, very... I assume they had... Like, I didn't actually manage to find... I'm kind of doing this one through hearsay, but I know it's out there. I've looked for it.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I don't know it, is because I don't know the title and I can't find it.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
But they could have, like, respirators or something, essentially,
yeah.
to breathe. Like, bring their own air or something.
Yeah.
Well, let us know in the comments if you ever happen to have encountered that.
I will, but I ran into that one decade plus ago, and
mm-hmm.
I still haven't been able to find it.
That sounds interesting, though.
Yeah. Really the only other stuff you run into is your standard predestination kind of thing where, and this is typically, this is how I run RPGs is usually with the predestination stuff. And then Star Trek does it a ton, whenever they go back. One of my favorite scenes in New Doctor Who is a predestination scene. And it's the, I don't know if you guys.
Yeah, no, I watch Doctor Who, yeah.
I don't.
I've seen it.
The first time he runs into Martha Jones, the very beginning of the episode, she's walking to the hospital. He walks up, yanks off his tie, and says, "There, see?" And the very next time that you see him, he's in a hospital bed and doesn't know who she is and is doing this other thing. At the very end of the episode, she's like, "You can't travel through time." He's like, "Yeah, I can." Steps into the TARDIS. When he comes back out, his tie is off.
Yeah.
It's pre-written. It's beautifully executed. It's totally predictable. But it's predestination. It's like he was meant to go back and do that because he'd already done it. That kind of
thing. This is Terminator.
Yeah.
They, no matter what they do, no matter how many spinoffs, no matter how many crazy things, that the stupid robots take over and there's an apocalypse.
That's actually why I don't like anything after the first one. Because in the first one, that doesn't matter. It's very interesting. The original Terminator is different from most other time travel movies.
No, I actually agree with you. Because I do agree. I think the first one's the best one.
Their whole goal is to change nothing. Like, they go back to, like, yeah, there's a horrible war. Tons of people die. We win. Don't touch anything. Don't touch anything at all. In fact, we're going to fulfill this predestination thing. I'm sending a guy back to be my dad. Like, I've picked him. That's what's going to happen. Whether or not he actually, like, knew that would be the guy or what.
Oh, he did. He had the photo.
No, he had the photo that he gave to him.
Right.
But he gave him the photo specifically so he would know who he was going to go back to protect.
Whether he picked that person to be his dad or whether he knew, because how many people had that same name? Who knows?
Yeah. That's a very good point. Like even though you could certainly make the argument that it's possible that he knew and he sent him back because he knew that he had to be his dad, it could also be that he chose him to go back.
But she's making the recording in the final scene.
Right, but he has no way of knowing what he looks like.
Yeah.
She says his name.
Yeah, but how many people have that name?
Kyle Reese?
Yeah, who knows? It's the future.
Well, it is a popular name.
Yeah, it might be. Who knows? And honestly, if she's talking about this guy so much, how many people are going to name their kids Kyle Reese?
You know, that's a good point.
Yeah.
And the recording could get lost. There's lots of...
Oh, yeah.
Well, no, he said he had the recordings. It's just...
Yeah.
I totally think he knew and sent the guy back because he's fulfilling the predestination thing.
No, yeah, it's very likely. And that's kind of implied. Yeah. No, and I agree with you. I think in the other ones, all the other Terminator movies, except for the first one, all have this, we have to go back and change history element to it. And the original one, it's the exact opposite. We have to go back to preserve history.
Two doesn't. Two changes in the middle of the movie, which is what bothers me, because the first half of the movie is, let's preserve it.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're right, you actually are right. Yes.
And then
in the middle of it, they're like, no, let's stop it from ever happening. Yeah, you're totally right.
Yeah,
and
the protagonist, her name is...
Sarah Connor?
Yes. Yeah. She's just like, wait, we have an opportunity, let's take it.
Mm-hmm.
But even then, if you just end it Terminator 2, there's a chance they succeeded.
Right.
They end it with, this might have worked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
especially the director's cut.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, I agree. I really, ever since, I mean, Terminator 2, ever since after that, I think the franchise has been complete garbage.
Really, the only other stuff is kind of like borderline time travel. You've got future viewing, like in the movie Paycheck, which is also a relativity theory, that if you can actually build a lens that allows you to see light from far enough and it lenses properly, you can see into the future.
Mm-hmm.
There's time dilation, which you see in the book Ender's Game. I don't know if it's in the movie, where by traveling at light speed, you get relative... the TV series Andromeda does the same thing.
Mm, yeah.
He jumps 300 years by falling into a black hole.
Right. Yeah, I've seen it. I haven't actually watched it.
Interstellar has stuff like that, too.
Yeah. And then you end up with a variation of it, which is cryo, so like Buck Rogers, that kind of a thing. And then, of course, I mentioned alternate past, which is things like time tracks... where a guy goes back and everything he does changes that past.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not trapped there, but he only gets one ticket back.
Mm-hmm.
So
give a nod to the movie Sphere, actually, which is about time travel as well.
I never finished that book.
You know, I think that Crichton got a bad rap for not being able to write endings, but I actually liked the ending of Sphere.
Does Crichton have a bad rap for not writing good endings?
Yes.
Yep. Really?
Quick, three-page endings.
Okay, yeah, okay, I can see that. No, I cannot see. I mean, because I've liked a lot of his stuff, but yeah, you make a good point.
The last one. Time Loops. Tragedy Looper. All You Need Is Kill, which is a great book. There's an episode of X-Files that does it. There's an episode of Star Trek. There's an episode of Early Edition that does the Looper story, which is actually Early Edition is technically time travel.
Yeah, it is.
Because the newspapers come from the future, which is another one I forgot.
Well, that's transmission of information.
Yes, but that is on my list. Data only from the future. Steins Gate falls into that for most of it. Yeah. It's only Data going back in time.
That's what I based the entire plot of Deus City on, the alternate reality game from 2006, 2007. It was the subject of my dissertation, actually. Was the idea that they're 30 years in the future, they're sending messages back, and all we have to do is preserve the archive, and they can read what we're saying, and communication happens.
That's what they do in Time Tracks. Anytime that he needs help from the future, he posts an ad in the classified section of the, I think, the New York Times or something, and they've gone through day by day the archives from the Smithsonian, and they send back what he needs.
Yep.
Cool. So time loop. But Groundhog Day is not time loop.
It is.
It is time loop.
I just don't use that as a reference for personal reasons.
Do you not like the movie?
I've never seen it.
Oh.
And the thing is,
I think it's a pretty fun movie, but then maybe you don't like Bill Murray. I don't know.
I also don't like comedies.
Oh.
They tire me out. I sit there and it's, I don't find the jokes funny.
You hate to laugh.
I don't find the jokes funny. So imagine if you're watching a comedy that was not funny and it had nothing else going for it. Would you watch it?
No, of course not.
Exactly.
But I actually think that there is more going, that there's more to Groundhog Day than just comedy.
Right.
There actually is, I think, a pretty good story there.
But I can't sit through the comedy. Because I don't find it funny, it actually annoys me, and I start to get angry, and then I can't do it.
There's a serious version that uses the same idea. It's called 1201.
Really?
Yes. And it is basically an office worker, and the guy is looping, and he's trying to figure out why he's looping, and it ties into what it is his company is really doing behind the scenes, what his boss is really doing. There's a love story tied into it, too.
So you're saying the looping mechanic is
the looping mechanic.
Well, the looping mechanic is everywhere. There's an episode of Pepper Ann that has the looping mechanic.
So wait, so 1201, is it a movie?
Yeah, it's a movie. It's a great movie.
Okay, I'll have to check that out.
But that was my point. Oh. Is this happens so often. 7 Days has it. Cartoons do it all the time.
Fair enough.
So 12 Monkeys, that's Predestination, right?
I haven't seen that one.
That's worth watching, too. It actually is. 12 Monkeys is really good.
I'll have to look it up.
Basically, Bruce Willis is sent back in time to stop this, like, you know, plague from happening. Mm-hmm.
The best part about it is that the it's said right from the beginning, listen, we can't change anything, but we can send you back in as an observer. The problem is time travel messes with your head, and also we haven't quite perfected, and we miss sometimes, so we're sending back the criminals and the crazy people.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it's the way that it all loops around and ties in together is beautiful.
Now, has anyone seen the 12 Monkeys television series?
No.
There is a new one that I have not seen it, but I've heard of it. And it recently has come out. I don't think the first season is even finished yet. But I was kind of curious to see if anyone's seen it and if there's any sort of impressions on its quality.
I'm very interested in
that. Might need to go check that out.
But yeah, I would recommend the movie if you're interested in time travel and time travel. Because it's very much presented as a... Is this guy crazy? What is actually happening here? What's really even going on in the future? Because there's a lot of like conspiratorial type stuff that happened in it. But
can you send me that title over like 12 social media?
12 Monkeys?
Yes.
Okay. Sure.
Cool.
So you
make sure I get it after this episode. That way.
You mean before the episode?
Well, for you guys.
Oh, right.
That way you can watch the first episode.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
So you mentioned earlier the type of time travel models you use in your role playing, which of course is a decent segue into Roll With It. We are currently airing at the time of play, not the time of recording, of course. We are doing River of Time, which you've ran well. What model do you use in that? Without spoiling too much about the actual story, but like, what was your model? What was your approach to River of Time?
So for River of Time, I did a little bit of Predestination. It's not... Is third episode?
Third episode will have aired by the time this is out. Yes.
Yes.
There's a little bit. It's a mixture of Predestination and the Branching Paths single world line effect. I mentioned Steins Gate. It's the same thing where in the original story... You go down one path, that's set. There are no alternatives. This is the only one, but you've changed it.
Okay.
The effect is permanent.
Which is why we can have such things as temporal consequences.
Right, yes. So that's the story I used. I like the predestination mechanic. because it makes it much easier for me to, without railroading the characters, mm-hmm. predict how they'll act.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was the third time travel story that I'd done as an RPG.
Mm-hmm.
I did another one fairly recently, or actually I'm in the middle of one.
Mm-hmm.
But in a previous one, what I did, it was an episodic-based system
mm-hmm.
where we had been rotating out GMs so that everyone got a turn to GM, everyone got a turn to play. It was great. But I did three straight episodes, and I spent a couple months planning out the entire story arc, pre-wrote lines of dialogue, pre-wrote scenes, and had to predict exactly what the characters would do in certain situations. I'd been playing with them, I'd been running games for them for a couple years, so it was much simpler. But with the predestination mechanic, I took them to three set locations in three different episodes. And then in a fourth episode, I took them back in the past. They had already seen the results of their actions.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a very interesting mix of one guy did whatever he wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
Because in his mindset, no matter what he did, that result was still going to happen.
Right.
It's what was going to end up.
Right.
I also had another player who was concerned about affecting the timeline. So he did everything he possibly could to preserve it.
Mm-hmm.
And that mix of those two characters, which I kind of figured is how they would play,
mm-hmm.
Made it work really well.
Nice.
Because they went back, they found all the things they needed, every action that they took. I mean, it was an RPG, I could railroad it a little bit,
mm-hmm.
and I worked that back in. And I tried to do some similar stuff with River of Time.
Cool.
I tried to keep it a little more open, just because it's a different mechanic. Mm-hmm. I did the branching stuff, so there were permanent effects. You guys started in a changed world,
mm-hmm.
rather than starting in a kind of set permanent world. So you start out with the idea of the stuff I do in the past does have ramifications. There's a consequence to the action.
Mm-hmm.
If I do this, it's going to change something.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it falls under kind of what I consider to be the Doctor Who kind of time travel,
mm-hmm.
where if you know the effects, or if you know the consequences of what happens in that time period, there's nothing you can do about it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't, you can do whatever you want because you'll end up in the stream.
Mm-hmm.
You'll just kind of... it's why he flies around blindly. He doesn't want to know because then he can't do anything about it.
Right. So we should probably start winding down, but we wanted to go in and do that quick sort of spitball a game based on one of these. So do we want to pick a model or try to mix models, or what do we think we want to do for that?
Well, Will, what sort of model do you think we should try to...
So, honestly, in a video game, I would pick a few of them
mm-hmm.
and base them on what kind of a character you're playing. I would split it up into like having three different classes, if you will. And each one of those has a different temporal effect. So one of them does something like Blinks, where he can control what point in time he is, like just relative on the platform.
Mm-hmm.
Another one has the ability to move into the past and then come back to the future. And then another one would have a mechanic of... Basically, it'd be a puzzle game, is what I would go with. A time-based puzzle game, which are not hard to find because they're the easiest method to do. If I was going to pick a single time travel mechanic, branching paths. The single, you have what you do affects the later game.
Which kind of already exists anyway anytime we have a branching narrative.
Yep.
So.
Well, that's a good point.
The only difference is I would make it to where some of your choices actually go back.
Mm.
Rather than constantly moving forward to a goal.
Mm-hmm.
So that you can actually end up in a loop
okay.
where if you keep making the same choice
okay.
or you keep not being able to find
mm. yeah.
that resolution you want,
mm-hmm.
you can jump back unless you miss the time travel device.
Gotcha.
Is it almost like that's railroading you to...
No, you'd be railroading yourself because the point would be you could keep going and accept what you did, or you could jump back and keep trying to undo it, almost like a save file.
You know what that reminds me of actually is... drawing a blank on the name. It was in that like 9999 series. Are you familiar with the one I'm talking about?
Yes, I've played this.
The one that was on PlayStation Vita. I'm drawing a blank on the name.
I didn't know they had one on Vita.
Virtue's Last Stand.
Yeah, okay, that was also on 3DS. It was on 3DS or DS. Anyway, I've played it.
Mm. The one that came before Virtue's Last Stand came on the DS.
and then they might have ported Virtue's Last Stand someplace else. I played it first on Vita.
Oh, okay. It is on 3DS as well, but sorry, I didn't know. It was on Vita.
But yeah, so Virtue's Last Stand, the idea there is that it's mostly kind of a visual novel sort of presentation.
Yeah, it really is.
Lots with and lots some of text. With some puzzle stages. But what will happen is you get to a decision point and you go basically one of two ways. And they actually show you the map of all the possible nodes of the story that you can see. And then basically what you do is when you start a new game or when you get sent back in time, you can make the same choices again and see the same path again. So in a way, it's basically like, They work into what would be happening anyway as just a player. You as the player being the time traveler, so to speak, outside of the world of the game. Except they do it diegetically, saying that your character is actually doing these loops and going through all these different nodes.
Does your character actually... Do you gain additional nodes when you go back?
Not that I'm aware of. But what does happen is that the player doesn't necessarily... Or the character doesn't necessarily remember what's happened. See, until you get to a point where down the line he starts to realize, oh wait, I've done this before, that sort of thing.
That's where I would change it, is as soon as you jump back, it's technically the same spot, and you can play it out exactly the same, but the second run, the second jump back, there's a couple more branching points.
Okay.
Just because I have information from that point. I know that this guy did this back here, I didn't know that before. So I can act on that now, because I know he's going to be there.
Which you can kind of do in a meta sense, but yeah, making it so that's built into the narrative would be interesting
too. No, I think that'd be interesting to do that as kind of a, to take that in the sense of it, you know, get a game that's taking place within one day, and, you know, at the end of the day, each time you're going back and you're making changes, like you said, it's opening up, every time you go back, you've got a little bit more information, so you're able to change a little bit more. So it's just kind of taking the looping theory, but just kind of...
Which is literally
all the sort of things that you can do in one
game. A game
day.
That kind of does that to an extent, and I haven't played enough of it to see how much they take advantage of it, is... I'm drawing a blank on the name. Life is Strange. There are elements
They do that a little bit.
For example, in a conversation, you'll talk to someone, and then they'll say something that gives you kind of a clue of how you could steer the conversation differently. Yeah. So you loop it back a little bit, and now you can have basically a third dialogue option that then changes the direction of the story.
No, and Majora's Mask does some of that.
That was actually my biggest complaint about Majora's Mask, is that after the third day it reset.
Yeah.
And you basically had to start over. If you missed something in a temple, you had to run that temple again. Drove me nuts.
Except for random things. The bank kind of made sense, because it was based on a tattoo that you had.
Right.
But there were other things that didn't. That you just could keep carrying. Like the masks. But honestly, to loop back for a second, that whole thing, tragedy looper. That is the mechanic of it. The knowledge that you pick up on each loop, because that's the whole point of the game. Mm-hmm. That's why it's a time travel game.
You're trying to basically solve the mystery before you run out of loops.
And since you're all player
characters... you have a limited number of loops.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
You have a limited number of days, so that's your forward motion. Then you get a number of loops that go back. The only thing you take back with you is knowledge.
And of course, that sort of a concept... It works a lot better, or at least it's easier to execute when it comes to a, you know, tabletop role-playing experience versus a video game, because you have to actually go in and try to program and make and account for all these different possibilities, whereas obviously if you have a GM, a real person, they can sort of do that on the fly if they want to.
Yeah, well,
if you try to throw some...
So I'm going to be a little arrogant here and say that trying to do a time travel RPG is really difficult.
Oh, no, I'm
every
not
single one that I've done has taken tons of planning,
right?
Simply because I don't like paradoxes.
Yeah.
I minimize them at all, if at all possible. Anyone can run a time travel RPG. It's pretty simple to have people travel through time.
No, what I'm saying is not that it's easy in the sense of to conceptualize it or set it up. I'm saying that from the standpoint of to actually in a video game, when you have all the limits that a video game does versus a human being that can be more fluid and potentially plan for all these different, you know, possibilities without having to have, for example, a budget to actually have, you know, art and sound and create all these different, you know, possible places that you can go and people that you can interact with in very different ways.
So mechanically,
yes,
it would still just be a linear game. Going back to Echo the Dolphin, there are points where you jump back just a short ways to where you were and redo it, and it's the same scene, but they've opened a new path. That's really all it is. So
no. But what I'm talking about is a lot more options, a lot more branching, a lot more. If I went back and redid this day again, I could do something completely 100% different. I could decide to get in my car and drive and, you know, start driving to Chicago and see how far I can get before the day ends. And that would be 100% different. In a video, and if we were playing, like, a tabletop game, assuming you don't, like, say, no, I refuse to let you do that, like, realistically, I could still do that. But in a video game, you would not be able to do that. There are limits in terms of, like, because you can't just let the player do literally anything because you haven't programmed. The world is only so big, you've only programmed so much, only so many characters you can interact with because you've only made that many characters.
Short of a cut scene, you're not able to do the thing Doctor Who did and go back in time and say, see there, either, you know? Because you can't force the player to do a thing in the future, and you can't reflect what it is they're going to do. This is the fundamental problem that I always talk to my students about, and why where all this came from really is a challenge that I used to throw down. Design a RPG for time travel. Will, you've come the closest to anybody that I've ever known. That's why you're sitting here.
There was a game. I cannot remember the name of it. But you run into a character and you interact with them. And then you travel through time. And to get back through that spot, you have to remember the sequence.
Oh, that's and the give it back. Monkey Island.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. So it can, you can...
Yeah, but it's still...
That's Monkey Island 2, right?
It's still feeding information and then asking them to remember. Right. It's not showing you what it is you will do.
There's...
Well, so, I mean, your character from, like, you're right, yeah, because it essentially, it does it for you the first time, like, the character gives you the stuff, and then when you go back, you have to be the character that gave you the stuff.
Because you're linearly playing that person.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But you could just as easily play the guy who goes back in time and runs into himself and hands the stuff to him. So, or gets the stuff handed to him.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
It's just turning that around.
That's actually one of my favorite moments in Betrayal at House on the Hill. Mm-hmm. So there are two cards in there where it is the mirror. And one is you get handed an object by your future self. And the other one is you have to hand an object through the mirror to your past self. Or vice versa.
Can you hand yourself anything? Is that...
Yeah, but what I love is whenever it's the same object. Because that can happen.
In 8-Bit Theater, which is almost as brilliant as Atomic Robo. They're written by the same guy, so I can say
that. Well, that makes sense.
There is a scene, since it's loosely based on Final Fantasy, the original, there's a scene where the thief, everyone levels up except for him, and then suddenly he's a ninja, and they don't explain it.
Yeah.
Later on, near the end, and this is spoiler, but that series ended nearly 10 years
ago. Yeah, it's been a while.
So I'm going to say it.
I actually was following that one as it was coming out.
We really don't mind spoilers all too much. It's more that we don't want to spoil each other if we really care. So.
Even then, there's enough of it that it's worth reading. Everyone gets depowered, except for him. And he's like, yeah, I'm fine. And then he appears, steals his power up, and goes back. Because originally he powered up by jumping into the future, stealing it from himself, and then playing the rest of the story. He just didn't know when he'd stolen it from him.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Speaking of, that game does have, you know, a time travel mechanic to it.
Yes, it does. A very important one.
Yeah, so. It's pivotal to the story.
And for the record, the system I ran, River of Time, the Atomic Robot RPG, is done by the same writer. So
that makes a lot of sense. That's cool.
Full circle.
Yay. Cool.
Well, I think we should close by just quickly stating what our favorite time travel story is.
Mm. Oh God, that's so hard.
That's very on the spot.
Do you mean favorite story because it's the favorite story because of the time travel, or favorite story that has time travel in it?
It's up to you.
Things.
I'll start. Mine's Primer, the movie. It was actually filmed, at least partially, in the Dallas area and our old stomping ground, UT Dallas.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I liked Primer a lot, actually. I thought it was a really, really cool concept for time travel. Yep. Very interesting. Have you seen Timer or Primer?
I know of it. I haven't watched it yet.
I think another one that I think you should check out just for the time travel elements are pretty neat.
I believe it's on Netflix, too.
So. Used to be.
Used to be, but you know how they take things, put things
I
on.
It was there last time I looked.
Yeah, cool. So.
Primer's a good choice. I guess for me, I mean, if I'm going video game, obviously I'd just pick Chrono Trigger just because I love the game so
why not?
Much.
That is great. The Sun Moon Stone is like the best mechanic in a video game.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
So I guess I'll go ahead and I'll stick with Chrono Trigger, I guess, if I was pressed in a movie. I'm a pretty big fan of, you know, the original, you know, the time machine, both the original story and the 1950s film.
The version. 50s one is fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah. Both of those, I would say, probably, because those were some of the earliest time travel stuff that I was exposed to. So I'll go ahead and I'll say that for non-video game.
I'd say for me, possibly not because it's got the best time travel in and of itself, but just because it's probably the time travel story that I most enjoyed, is probably Majora's Mask. That's just an all-time classic game for me, and I still love it. So if I had to pick one, that'd probably be it.
Okay.
I'm going to cheat a little bit, because my opinions on what makes the best time travel story change, depending on some most recent things. Game-wise, I'm going to go with Echo, the whole Echo franchise, just in general. There's some really cool concepts in it, some really cool mechanics, and it comes from an era where they're making video games. You get Sparkster, who's a magic possum rocket knight. You don't run into those as often anymore. So it's a dolphin who travels through time to save his family from the Independence Day aliens.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Spoilers.
No, concept-wise, I think it's really cool.
Yeah.
I love a lot of those old concepts, because they could just do pretty much anything that popped into their head and make it work. So there's a lot more creativity there.
I love it.
Yeah.
Movie-wise, I'm actually going to have to split that one up, because most recently I watched The Girl Who Leapt Through Time, which I was a little worried about, but is a fantastic movie.
I agree.
The animated one, I haven't seen the live-action one. My understanding is the story's a little bit different.
Yeah, a lot different, actually.
So
I would say the live action version is only worth watching if you are interested in seeing the film's version of 1970s Japan.
I'd be fine with that. So
if you're interested in that, because that I thought that part fascinated me in terms of the way that the story played out. Pretty lame, but that aspect of it was cool. But yeah, the animated one is really cool.
It's brilliant. It has the time travel mechanic is there, but is not the central point. It's the thing that moves it. In the same vein, this is an anime and a visual novel, Steins Gate, because it has a very with the exception where they just blunder, and one scene at the end, their time travel rules are kept solid throughout, and the entire story is not so much about traveling through time as it is about the consequences of messing with time. And not even what happens to that, but what you have to do to fix it, and the consequences of that. Because the basic premise is there's only one guy who can remember. And in fooling around with time, he messes a bunch of stuff up, and every step back to fix it, he's the only one who remembers the ramifications of it, and the things it cost people.
Gotcha.
Nice. Well, since y'all did video games, I'll say mine then. We'll close on that. Singularity, actually. It's set in Russia. It has a sort of Bioshock feel, and to me, it's a much stronger entry of time travel than Bioshock Infinite was, even, which arguably is not really about time travel at all, but about parallel universes. But yeah, you end up on this experimental island that the Russians were doing bad things on, and then you start going back and forth between 1955 and the present because of the experiments they were doing. And you end up being able to channel time energy into old stairways and make them old and make them new and that sort of thing. There's nothing more fulfilling than having this enemy who you cannot beat with your guns, and you just instead you turn him to dust because you decide you're going to channel time energy and make him really old. Singularity, fun game.
I wanted to play that one.
Yeah,
is that good. By Sega? Is that published by Sega?
I don't think so.
I believe you're supposed to say Sega.
Sega.
That would be more what I'd go with.
I just remember their, like, you know,
Raven.
Their extreme 90s Raven commercials.
Was that the developer?
Sega.
Developed by Raven Software, and I played it on PS3.
Sega publishes for everything. So.
Yeah, that's true. Activision.
Okay. There were a couple games that came out there I may have been thinking of as something else, so...
Well, thank you everyone for joining us for episode number 28 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Will.
And I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time, in the future, or the past, or something.
Yeah.
Bye.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, tell us your favorite and least favorite time travel models, or whether they've ever changed your view of the fiction. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.